It's Monday, October 11th. Coming up live on The View. You won't believe your ears in Hot Topics. From ugly name-calling and mudslinging on the campaign trail to why Anderson Cooper is offended by something Vince Vaughn says in his new movie. And the shocking messages that have quarterback Brett Favre caught in a sexting scandal. Plus, Geraldo Rivera's looking back at four decades of his greatest, wildest, and most embarrassing moments on TV. And revealing why Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg ran away from him last week. Then, it's the question that has women pulling their hair out. Curly or straight? View Crew celebrity hairstylist Brian Renfro's revealing which look is right for you. And R&B hitmaker Tayo Cruz is taking the stage to sing his latest hit, Dynamite. All that, hot topics and more, coming up on The View.
Monday morning.
I know.
I mean, my goodness. But I say hello and welcome to The View. We're happy you're here. Happy Columbus Day.
That's right.
Yeah. I guess he discovered America today.
Well, he didn't really discover it. The Indians were here already.
He discovered it for the white people. I mean, that's what it's like. Yeah. You know, him and Amerigo Vespucci.
That's right.
Yeah. A lot of Italian people coming
through
here.
Which, you know, America is named after Amerigo Vespucci. Yeah. I don't know if people realize
Amerigo.
That.
Amerigo.
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 Oh, yes. But you know what?
You
it doesn't
Italian.
Matter. We're here. We're here.
It's here.
You know, who cares? So what? Who cares? It's you. Right. You know, the Chilean miners trapped underground for the past 68 days could be free men as early as today. But, yeah. It's great. But, you know, some will have a lot of explaining to do to their wives. Who ran into their husbands' mistresses at the vigil site, praying for their safe return.
Yeah, they didn't know about each other.
Yeah, so well, that's the whole idea with a mistress, right? You're not supposed
to know. You're not supposed to know. Yeah.
They're probably saying, look, I'll stay down here, okay? You go. Yeah. You go.
And they actually got into a little fisticuffs.
Oh, yeah.
The mistress and the wife.
They did. They got into a fight. Well, yeah, I mean, nobody's lying. Nobody wants that one. You know, you're there worried about your husband, and then Tom is praying next to you.
Can you imagine they've been down there 33 days, more than 30, excuse me, but he finally comes up, you know, dehydrated and malnourished, and he's got to deal with, you know, placating the wife or the mistress.
Spanish women do not care, baby. Spanish women will take you out.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. They'd be like,
yeah.
That's it.
Being rescued from the mine and then being taken out by the wife.
Only to be taken out by your wife. You know, it's crazy. Well, listen, we move on to something else. Anderson Cooper said he couldn't believe what he heard in a recent movie trailer. He didn't mention a movie by name, but he was most likely talking about the new Vince Vaughn film, The Dilemma. Take a look.
Electric cars are gay. I mean, not homosexual gay, but, you know, my parents are chaperoning the dance. Gay.
What does it mean? What is he talking about?
It's like lame. I think, you know, when people say, oh, it's gay, it's like that's...
Why did they just say gay? I mean, lame, rather.
That's what I said. Lame used to be said. There was a time when people would go, that's so lame. And then I think it just kind of left the vernacular. That
well, the gay audience, gay people do not like it anymore because it has a negative, derogatory connotation. It's not like, in other words, it's weak. You're weak.
Right.
The electric car is weak. Your parent. Another point in the movie was your parents are chaperoning you. That's gay.
Yeah, but the other thing is, it's like people throw around the word retarded. You know, we would say, oh, that's so retarded. Right. You know,
folks don't like it.
They just are not into it.
Doesn't it seem to be, especially in light of all of these things that are happening with gay people, you know, the bullying, you know, we just had something in the Bronx that just happened.
It was terrible.
Some teenagers got tortured and beat up who were gay. it just seems like there's this resurgence of stuff. I know there's a cartoon called The Boondocks, and now people are saying this phrase. You know, it's no homo. That's what they say, you know.
Meaning what?
Meaning, like, if you say I love you to another man, you go, but no homo. So it's a phrase
I think it should be common sense. If you're using it and it does have a negative connotation and you know that indeed it would hurt someone, and in fact you're not saying it in front of anyone who is gay, which means then you would never say it in front of someone who was, bottom line would be you shouldn't say it.
But
I don't know where the common sense is.
They do say it in front of people who are gay. That's just like this term.
Not all the time. I think when they're using it in a derogatory sense, you'd be surprised. They probably say it in an environment in which they feel safe to say it.
Nobody wants to hear you say it. You know, but you take your life into your hands when you do. You know, you don't want to be running around talking about that's so gay. You just don't want to do it. Unless you're a gay person and you can defend that, you don't need to be saying it. You can say that's lame. There are enough words in the English language that people can find ways to say
it. A lot of these thugs will not use the N-word in front of black people.
No.
Because they're going to get it back. They're not afraid of gays, you know. So why don't they say that's so Muslim, see what happens.
Or that's so Italian.
Or that's so Italian. Say that in Arthur Avenue and see how that plays.
You know?
Say where? Arthur Avenue.
That's so Guinea.
You say that's so Guinea. If
somebody said that's so Guinea, you would not forget it. You just wouldn't make it. I mean, you know, try using some new words that maybe you find in a dictionary. You know, there are enough of them to talk about what's crappy.
Sure.
It's crappy to do this, it's crappy to do that. Even you could even use the F word if it made you crazy enough.
Find a good word in the dictionary.
Yeah, there's a lot of good words in the dictionary. But you know what? What's not in the dictionary is the fact that we're coming right back. But maybe our hot topics are, so we'll see.
And we're starting a new segment called V-Mail, which means that you can now send us your questions for the co-hosts of The View. Just go to our website and I don't know how it works. It's magic. Anyway, you want some examples? We did a little something with our staff.
My question for the co-host would be, what's your favorite book and what's your favorite song on your iPod?
My husband and I have been married for 6 years. We have one amazing child and 2 separate bank accounts. Everybody on the planet has a problem with it but us. What do you guys think?
Sherry, you know, you're always talking about how you're single and you want to be dating. I was wondering if you'd ever consider online dating.
The one thing I would never do is tell someone I have bad breath. But what if I have bad breath? How would I ever know? No one's gonna tell me.
Yeah, they weren't very good. You'll be much better than that. So send us your videos and we'll put them on. You can be a star, sort of.
So, the nasty race for New York governor between Andrew Cuomo and Tea Party candidate Carl Paladino has been making national headlines. And now Paladino is under fire, child. He does not learn.
He's just a fool. He's a fool.
Well, you know, tell him what happened now.
Well, he made some comments at a meeting with Jewish leaders. Well, take a look. We'll show you.
I didn't march in a gay parade this year. The gay pride parade this year. My opponent did. And that's not the example that we should be showing our children, and certainly not in our schools. And don't misquote me as wanting to hurt homosexual people in any way. That would be a dastardly lie. My approach is live and let live. I just think my children and your children will be much better off and much more successful getting married and raising a family. And I don't want them to be brainwashed into thinking that homosexuality is an equally valid or successful option. It isn't.
This is just
stupid. Well, and he's playing to his base, and he's telling religious people what they want to hear because of, you know, some religious thing. But this is what causes people on the down low, may I just say. You know, if you go out there and you tell people that homosexuality is a sin and it's bad in these closed communities, what they do is they are gay, a lot of them. They act out on the sly and then bring it back to their so-called heterosexual marriages. Like he's doing. A very dangerous guy,
yeah,
this
don't,
one.
I wouldn't just write it off as just, you know, simply stupid either. I think there is a pointed aim here. And I also, it bothers me when politicians consistently will use the gay community as a pawn during election time. And we're going to see it in a bigger way coming forward. And I just wish they wouldn't.
And you know what? The Jews should know better, these Jewish leaders. Because when people are obsessing against anti-Semitism, that's the scapegoat that they used in Germany and other places all over the world. Jew, Jew, Jew. Now it's gay, 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 or homo, homo, whatever it is. It's a scapegoat. It's very dangerous in bad economic times that we're in now because people always look
as
for
we're
scapegoats.
Seeing right
and
now.
So they're doing bad things in the Bronx, yes, this weekend.
Yes.
A horrible assault on these guys.
Which is interesting. I mean, what is going on? Because it's in a way, we see more tolerance in some ways, right? And then we see these vicious acts.
We're going back.
Deadly acts, and it's I don't understand how both of those
statements like
at the same time.
Create an environment where these thugs feel that they have a right to attack homosexuals.
I think it's
don't
not
think
only
that they're not connected. Those things are connected.
It's also coming through churches.
Yeah.
It's coming through these sort of BS organizations that, you know, keep our children's minds pure. Let me tell you something. Now, this is America where you can be whoever you want to be. You get to be who you want to be. Leave folks alone. You worried about gay people? Don't marry a gay person. Back up. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. You know, and this idea that people are brainwashing children. You know, I'm sorry. You can't brainwash someone. Children know enough to talk to their parents if they have questions. It doesn't work that way.
I also think it should be left up to, and I do think, I agree with you, Whoopi, and I also think some of the concern that's then becoming exaggerated and turning into rage is that someone will get to your kids first about talking to them about sex and homosexuality, heterosexuality, and I believe that many parents do want to maintain that control. So I think that is just getting blown out of proportion. I think parents just don't want
to
lose control. You shouldn't create hate, and you should
try to
understand
this. It's like this mass hysteria is happening now. They're going to get your children. They're going to get your children.
And then you start. But now, like I said, we're seeing more and more of these violent acts that are happening with teenagers. Teenagers are committing these.
Yes, but you know what? These are not the children who have been indoctrinated. I wish that Carl Paladino had said, you know what? I don't want to see anybody beating up anybody because they are not 100% behind their lifestyle, or they're the wrong color, or they're the wrong ethnic makeup. But that's not what he's doing.
No.
That's what he should. If he really wants to, like, do something, this is New York City where we have a plethora of people.
Right. The other thing, though, Whoopi, is that he says that he's not homophobic because he's got a kid in his family, a niece or nephew who's gay.
That doesn't make you a mean.
It's like having a black friend. Not buying it.
No. So what he's really doing is pandering for votes.
Exactly,
and he thinks that is an evil thing to do because not only you're a hypocrite at the same time and a liar.
Well, he's using, as I said, them for.
You know, even when he was reading from the speech, it didn't sound like he was committed to what he was reading.
It sounded like he was committed to what he was reading. Viable candidate in Andrew Cuomo. Just go there. He's a very smart guy, and he makes the Italians look good. May I just say? And this guy does not.
Do the Italians look bad everywhere else?
Well, Paladino is unfortunately one of the.
You cannot assign a stereotype good and bad where you feel like it. You can't say he makes the Italians look good, he makes the Italians look bad. Isn't that then doing the same thing that we're saying not to do?
Michelangelo Snooki, what do you think?
I agree with you, but you can't get it. Are we talking race?
There is no comeback to that. We will be right back with even more Hot Topics. The NFL says it's investigating allegations that quarterback Brett Favre sent racy messages and photos to sideline reporter Jen Sturger when he was playing for the Jets in 2008. Now...
Well, they were full frontal nudity, I understand.
Yeah, I saw allegedly. The pictures. It was, oh, I don't
really?
Know.
We,
yeah, I saw. We don't know
if those are Brett Favre's pictures because
pictures
it's not
penis.
Him holding a penis going, hey, babe. They're just a picture. They're just snapshots of a
There was just
a,
penis. And you said this could be anybody. It was a picture
anybody.
Of a, it was a picture of a penis. Thank you, Jason, our head researcher, came and he was like, I got pictures of the penis, so I went running. And I don't understand why, and I'm not saying this is Brett Favre, but why a man thinks it's just so sexy to just send a... Because even when I saw it, I was like, oh, man.
But he had a white... attached to anything?
Yeah, it was attached to a torso.
It sounds like it's just flying in the
air. But it was a hand. It was a hand. Watch on.
We don't know and have no confirmation.
We don't know. That could be... That could be... Everybody knows.
No,
unless you're... You don't know, do you? Okay, that's all I'm saying. It could be anybody's.
It could be anybody's, and I do hope that it's a little suspicious that this story, which has been hanging on Deadspin, which is a place you can go for information, for so long, and then it would come out right now on just the eve of the Vikings-Jets game, which is tonight. So you have to wonder if there's some media buildup about this just to draw people to that game.
So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to say, Brett, if it's yours, send me a picture, and I'll verify it. Now, Elizabeth... You were a little shocked at what you saw at another football game over the weekend. What happened?
We were just hanging out on Saturday and as a family went to a high school football game, which we loved it. It was two great teams were playing. But there was this one dad on the sidelines yelling profanities. What the are you doing out there? You guys don't know what you're yelling the entire time. I haven't been to a high school game in a long time. I wanted to approach him and tell him to just button it up right now before I, like, pummel him. And Tim said, you can't do that. You know, this is a guy on the sidelines. You got to let him say what he's going to say. And I think he struggled because we were there with the kids, but he also thought, you're probably going to get me into a situation that
I'm sorry.
But I just don't understand why parents or anyone on the sideline of a football game with a bunch of kids who are staying out of trouble, doing what they can to just play their hardest, would go out on such a rant against them. So you know who you are.
Against the kids he was yelling?
Yes. Not against the coaches.
I remember my ex-husband coached a basketball team at the local Y, and a lot of the fathers did that. They would scream at him and they would scream at the kids.
It's not okay. Because, number one, when your children see you acting like that, they think it's okay.
Well, none of the mothers ever did it. I wonder why a man feels that they would do it.
Women do it, too. Women scream just, and they call the coach and the players and their mamas talk about it. It's, you know what? There's a way to be a fan where you don't have to, like, scare the little kids that are sitting there.
You talk about it.
Give stuff. Yeah, I talk about it in my book, you know. Is it just me?
Is it just me?
That's the name of my book.
Which is on sale now at bookstores.
Which is on sale.
You need Whoopi's book because it is that good and on point.
It's fun, you know, and more fun to be had because when we come back, we're bringing back Geraldo Rivera. So, come back.
A trailblazing, fearless newsman and talk show host behind some of the most unforgettable moments in TV history. Please welcome back Geraldo Rivera. Hi, Geraldo.
Thank you.
Now, you gotta say, we're glad that you're here. You know, The Social Network came out the past couple weeks, and it's been number one, but we heard that the CEO of Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg, kind of blew you off.
He did. It was amazing. I covered this press conference where he very generously gave $100 million to the Newark school system. And then Cory Booker, the mayor of Newark there, on your right, invited me back. And Mark Zuckerberg took a look at me, and he wouldn't shake my hand.
There was some fear in his eye.
Charles Manson shook my hand. Yasser Arafat shook my hand. Yeah, he just saw me and he froze, and he's this little tiny man, and to think of that little tiny man being worth $5 billion
is kind of... Is he a germaphobe or something?
It may be. Yeah. It may be.
But he's socially awkward, they say, as well.
Well, I saw that for myself, but, you know, I never engendered that particular... I felt like a mugger. They invited me. It wasn't like I was crashing the party. It was just...
Well, Geraldo, we want to congratulate you for 40 years of journalism.
Sure. Thank you.
Congratulations to you. You have had... Your ride has been one of the wildest. I remember distinctly in 1988 when the skinheads got on your show and they had a chair and they were fighting and one broke your nose.
Ennis, there I am. There's the chair.
Look, I remember
there's
that.
The chair, and then I grabbed the guy in the plaid chair. If you look at the right, I'm on top of him, and you know, but my nose was already broken. Look, he had a plumber's crack. I was trying to deal
with
him.
But when you see that, what do you think when you see that now?
You know, I think that sometimes you have to confront hate with vigor. You can't just turn the other cheek at times. And once they hit me after the vile things they were saying, you know, I had no choice but to battle it out.
Who threw the first punch?
I guess Roy Ennis, the chairman of the Congress of Racial Equality, and the other guy. But then they threw the chair at me. It was clear to me that they planned to make a riot out of the show. You know, they came with that attitude. Sure. And, you know, I've always in my life been, you know, I'm the kind of person that if you push me, I'll push you back. Right. If you love me, I'll love you back. You know, it's just I think that too many people... Sometimes turning the other cheek doesn't work, and particularly with hateful people, you're talking about the guys that assaulted the gays up in the Bronx. Yeah. They really deserve what's coming to them.
I hope
now.
So.
You know, they deserve to in Rikers Island prison what they gave to that boy in the Bronx.
He'll
it was just
it.
Horrible. Yeah.
Your only fist fight, you certainly do act on that mantra there. In 1992, you got into another fight with another neo-Nazi and ended up getting arrested. Take a look.
I'm not talking to you because you're part Jew and part Spick, and that doesn't really count. You're a piece of your welcome's about out. You better get out of here.
Or what?
Or that.
What
the
You know, I come from two very easily insultable groups, you know, part Jew, part Spick. I mean, what are you going to do?
But they're more than part ugly. That guy was,
really.
What a thotch on him.
I got to ask you a question, because my first real remembrance of you as a journalist comes with Willowbrook, which was an amazing, amazing discovery. Can you briefly tell me how you got to there? And did I steal somebody's question?
Okay. Willowbrook, at the time, in the early 70s, was the world's largest institution for the mentally retarded. And it was, I think, one of the worst on Earth. And the irony is that it was right here in New York City, as you know, Whoopi, 6,500 severely, profoundly retarded, mostly young people, right on Staten Island. And I had a source inside, a doctor, a young doctor I'd worked with before, and they got me a key, and I went inside that place, and what I saw was horrifying. Yeah. You know, in an area half the size of this studio, crammed with youngsters being, neglected, naked, smeared with their own feces. They were being treated worse than animals in a dog kennel.
I think you changed the system with that.
Well, that expose, it took a long time. I'm still deeply involved. Now they've totally deinstitutionalized the care of the developmentally disabled. And I wear it as a medal of honor. I see so many people now. I could just cry thinking about it. Who say that my uncle was there, my sister was there, or I got into the area of dealing with developmentally disabled children because of what they saw. Right. It was the best example, I think, of the new, you know, one of my pet peeves is people doing an expose, you reveal a problem, and then you walk away from it.
It happens a lot.
And this was trying to bring about a social change.
Right.
To deinstitutionalize. Now they're in these small community-based facilities, four, five, six of them, instead of 4, 5, 6 thousand of them.
Right.
And it really has changed, and I'm so proud of it.
You can die a proud man.
I can, if it stopped at that.
Yeah.
People remember the flamboyant things, they remember the fights or, you know, the marriages.
The argument, you had an argument with Bill O'Reilly about immigration. What was that about? We have a clip, but tell us what it was about.
Well, you know, Bill and I, just generally. O'Reilly's my colleague and in many ways a good friend of mine. But we see the world through very different perspectives. Right. But in this particular case, the vast majority of my audience agrees with him and not me. I believe that you need a comprehensive immigration program. This is a nation of immigrants. We have to, of course, secure our borders. But to see how they are stereotyped and to see how they are blamed for everything from raping our wives to stealing our jobs to committing disproportionate numbers of crimes, and the stereotypes are false. I'm here to tell you folks that they really are, that immigrants bring vigor to our country, that diversity from the four corners of the earth. We are all. We are all. They're the people who will save Social Security. And I really believe in many ways that it's too easy to stereotype people who look different than we do.
Don't obscure a tragedy to make a cheap political point.
I'm the father.
It's a cheap political
point. No, it isn't.
And you know
this is justice.
This has nothing to do with that poor O'Reilly mayor.
You want
anarchy. Nothing to do with that mayor.
You want anarchy.
No, what I
want. You want open border anarchy.
What I want is fairness. We have lured these people. We have lured these
people. This is the law.
We have lured these people to this country with a promise of jobs.
That was as close I ever came to a fight that I didn't have one.
We also have another clip that I want to ask you about. You went undercover several times. You were undercover. Let's look at a clip of you backstage in 1986 setting up a drug sting.
The disadvantage of being on television for a while is that you can't go undercover unless you change the way you look. What do you think? Do I make a convincing dope crook?
Pick up a glass for me. You look like Eduardo Rivera.
When the doper thinks he recognizes me, I decide the best defense is a good offense. It's a maneuver to get him to change the subject. And it works.
You kept me here for 5 hours, I mean, what are you, some big Then where's the dope, man?
The word that would trigger the police assault is candid camera.
I got three things to say to you. Number one.
You know, you just sold a kilo of cocaine to Geraldo Rivera.
Geraldo, we gotta get out of here.
There's no one like here.
We want to wish you safety in your travels and good luck because you're going to Afghanistan next week. So we wish you well. And thank you so much to Geraldo Rivera. And members of our audience are taking home his book, The Great Progression, which just came out in paperback. We're gonna be right back.
Struggled with two important questions. What's the meaning of life, and should I straighten my hair? So, we sent View Crew celebrity hairstylist Brian Renfro on a quest to find the answer to curl or not to curl. That is the question. Take a look.
I've got two damsels in hair care distress. One wants to go curly, one wants to go straight. Wait till you meet them.
Hey, Brian!
Anna Marie, Gina Marie, the two cutest twins that you've ever met.
Growing up, it's been like a battle.
Oh my goodness. Like, everyone called us Shirley Temple when we were younger.
That was
crazy.
Cute then. That was cute. I don't want to be Shirley Temple anymore.
You look like Shirley Temple.
You look worse than Shirley Temple.
That's mean.
They have the same hair. It's wild, it's crazy. Anna Marie, I'm going to teach her how to work with her curls naturally by using the right products. Gina Marie, we're going to make her hair straight with a keratin complex treatment. So she'll be able to blow it dry and keep it straight without having the frizz. We're going to do that, and we're going to see which one they like the best.
You're here at Divashon Salon, which is the mecca for curls. Lorraine, what is it that you know about curly hair that no one else seems to know?
All the curly girl wants to do is straighten it. She thinks that's her only mean of control, and it really isn't. You can pretend all you want you're not naturally curly, but that's not going to make it go away. Forever you're going to have curls.
How are you cutting her hair?
I'm going to start to shape her hair as her hair falls. Yes, it is dehydrated right now, but I can get more of a read on a curl than I would if her hair was wet.
You don't wet it to cut it?
No, we cut our hair dry. We have to. We have to, because we have to know what we're working with. You see, every curl on her head is where it's supposed to be.
Does it matter if the hair is one length or layered?
I think curly girls tend to, because they're so scared, they keep their hair one length.
One length?
What stops the hair from billowing out is actually hydration. The day I stopped using shampoo was the day I started losing my curls.
Wait a minute, you don't use shampoo? What do you use?
I use a product called No Poo. And No Poo, it has no detergents, there's no lather, so it doesn't make our hair feel frizzy or dry.
Okay, so you've cleansed, now what are you going to do?
So now what we're going to do, I'm going to flip our head over, which is kind of a natural, our hair will fall in its natural position.
Okay.
We're not using any combs or brushes, we're just using our hands.
Right, because combs and brushes, they cause frizz, don't they?
They cause a lot of friction and frizz, and just like you said before, our hands were designed way before the brush and the comb.
Yeah, they are.
And then what you're going to do is you're going to bring your head up and look up to the ceiling, and just shake.
Keeping it loose,
keeping it
moving.
It loose, yep.
Not any stress on it,
no
so
stress.
It can move.
And then there it is in its natural position.
Lorraine, this looks so amazing. It's really, really beautiful. I'm going to let you keep working. Anna Marie, we're going to go straighten out your sister. I hear Japanese, and now I'm hearing keratin. What's the difference?
Okay, well, first there was the Japanese straightener, and that's like a perm. That chemically changes the shape of the hair.
Okay.
Then there's keratin complex. Our hair is made up of 86% keratin when we're born.
Right.
And as we age and as we color our hair, we lose that keratin. Okay. So when we infuse the keratin, which is a protein, into the hair, it gives it that youthful, straight, soft look, dries quick, can't frizz, leaves the hair amazing. Okay, first I'm gonna wash our hair 3 times with clarifying shampoo. Then I'm gonna dry it naturally. Then I'm gonna take-
You mean blow it dry?
Blow dry it natural, correct, no conditioner.
Right. What you're really doing now is you're infusing the keratin. You're covering every hair, but not necessarily the straightening process yet?
That's correct. You know, ethnic women, women that have relaxers, it's amazing for a woman.
So you can do this over a relaxed hair? You comb that through?
Comb it through. Then I'm gonna put a processing cap on for 25 minutes.
To soften it. So
to soften it, and more so to allow the keratin to sink into the cuticle.
Because you've opened the cuticle with the shampoo.
Exactly. Okay. I'm gonna dry her hair, and the magic is when I go back and flat iron it. That's how it works. And that lamination will last for 3 to 5 months. And as time goes on, it'll gradually wear off the hair, leaving her with no line of demarcation, so there's no commitment.
So take a look. Martino really gave you the straight hair you wanted.
Look at how the girls look before. We have that here. So we see the frizz, what they were dealing with all along.
Right.
And then, oh gosh, we can't even wait to see them. Can you bring them out? Come on out, Anna Marie and Gina Marie. How do you both feel about your new look?
I absolutely love it. I love it, Curly.
I love it.
I mean, this is just luscious.
I'm so happy. I really am.
I'm so happy. I'm
wow.
So thrilled.
So do you think you'd ever go back to the curls?
No.
Never.
I love this. I mean, even when it air dries, I love it because it has body and it still has a little bit of wave in it. So, and yeah, it's amazing. It's very versatile.
And those curls are lush.
Thank you. I always thought that I would go back to straight, but after having this and just knowing what I can do with it and how this is me, this is how I was born, I absolutely adore them. And oh, I couldn't think of like drawing
no chemicals
them.
In your hair. This actually
not.
There's formaldehyde in this, right, Brian?
There's a tiny little bit.
Uh-huh.
It's encapsulated. And I must tell you though, when we did this in the salon, I smelled nothing. That's the issue that you hear about in the news right now about the Brazilian.
But I had it done. I have the keratin also.
Right, yeah.
Right.
So you see, it leaves your hair with plenty of body.
Plenty of beautiful
right.
body.
I mean, you can
but
right.
when they put, I have to
hair.
Say, when they put it on, even with a little bit of formaldehyde, your eyes do tear a little bit. But it's supposedly okay. I'm just
well,
saying.
Well, there's formaldehyde. And
just
everything. It's
careful.
The gas that's released. Yeah, you should do it in a ventilated space, that's
okay.
for sure.
What about cost and maintenance? What are we looking at?
The keratin complex treatment is about $350. Some places have specials, but then you have to use a certain shampoo in the end to follow up with it because it keeps confusing keratin into it, and sometimes the sulfates and shampoos would wash it out. And in the case of Anna Marie, she uses no sulfate shampoos from Divasan, which also help keep her curl because it keeps it hydrated, and that's
These
what Lorraine
girls will
was
look
talking
good
about.
No matter
that's
what
fantastic.
They wear.
This is the segment of the big whole thing is to have a choice.
Our great thanks to Brian Renfro. Hey, and everyone in our studio audience is going home with products from Divasan and Keratin.
Thank you.
biggest songs of the summer with Break Your Heart, and his new single Dynamite is racing up the charts and constantly playing on my iPod. Here to perform Dynamite from his CD Rockstars, Tayo Cruz.
I came to dance, 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 dance. I hit the floor cause that's my plans, 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 plans. I'm wearing all my favorite brands, 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 brands. Give me some space for both my hands, 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 hands. Yeah, yeah, cause it goes on. Came to move, 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 move. Get out the way of me and my crew, 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 crew. I'm in the club, so I'm gonna do, do.